Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Priya Sipaha. Today my topic is Significant Provision for Women in the Indian Legal System, Part 2. Part 1 I have already discussed in my previous video. So let's start. As I have already discussed in my previous video, that our legal system has provided many rights and many laws pertaining to protect women and keep on amending time to time. And I have also mentioned Nirbhaya case in this context. Because after Nirbhaya case in 2013, there are n number of amendments has been made in the criminal law. Most of the amendment I have already explained in my previous video. Now in this video, I will explain only two provisions. First one is amendment in rape laws and second is sexual harassment at the workplace. Both are very lengthy, that's why I am discussing only two provisions in this particular video. So let's start. The first one is the most brutal one, that is rape. In general, everybody is aware about the rape, but technically or legally, rape has been defined under section 375 of Indian Penal Code 1860, which states that a man is said to commit rape if he himself is committing intercourse, or if he is using any object, or if he is manipulating any body part or making any other person to do so with him or any other person, or if there is an application of mouth to another's private parts, or make such person to do so with him or to any other person, or if he is touching the private parts of any other person, or makes that person to touch his or any other person's private part, then it comes under the category of rape. Now the second part is pertaining to consent, which is very important if you have to define rape laws. If any person is committing any sort of act which has been discussed in my previous slide against her will or without her consent, or with her consent, when her consent has been obtained by putting her or any other person in whom she is interested in fear of death or hurt, or with her husband when a man knows that he is not her husband and that her consent is given because she believes that he is another man to whom she is or believes herself to be lawfully married. That means that lady is believing that he is her husband. Or any type of consent which is given by the person who is of unsoundness of mind or who is intoxicated, or if that person is unable to understand the nature and consequence of that to which she gives consent. That means she must be so much intoxicated either or mentally ill, or with or without her consent when she is under 18 years of age, or when she is unable to communicate consent. If these are the things, these type of consent has been gained by the person, and if he is going to do the act which has been defined in the previous slide, that will come under the category of rape. Basically, consent is a very technical term. It means an unequivocal voluntary agreement when the woman by words or gesture or any form of verbal or non-verbal communication communicates willingness to participate in the specific sexual act. But if a woman is not doing so, that will come under the category of rape, provided that a woman who does not physically resist to the act shall not be reason only of that fact be regarded as consent to the sexual activity. That means if a woman is not resisting, it does not mean that woman is welcoming anyone to do a sexual act. Still, there are certain exceptions. The first one is a medical procedure or intervention shall not constitute rape because it is a checkup. Second, any sexual act by a man with his own wife, the wife not being under 15 years of age, is not rape. That means if the wife is not below the age of 15, it will not be considered as rape. But later on, The crime of sexual assault on a child, that is anyone below the age of 18, is further outlined and mandatory punishment describes in the Protection of Children from Sexual Offence Act 2012, that is POCSO Act. Punishment of rape has been defined under Section 376 of Indian Penal Code. 376 is further divided into two parts. The first one is 376(1) for the common man and 376(2) for the official. So let's discuss 376(1). It states that whoever commits rape shall be punished with imprisonment of not less than 7 years, but which may be for life or for a term which may extend to 10 years and shall also be liable to fine. Unless the woman raped is his own wife and is not under 12 years of age, in which case he shall be punished with the imprisonment of 2 years or with fine or both, provided that the court may, for adequate and special reason to be mentioned in the judgment, impose a sentence of imprisonment for a term of less than 7 years. That means otherwise, for rape, the punishment is 7 years, which may extend to life imprisonment and 10 years. And if a rape is committed on wife, it may be for 2 years, if the wife is less than age of 12 years. Now the punishment under Section 376(2) of IPC. Section 376(2) of IPC is again categorized into 7 parts, out of which first 4 part is related to custodial rape. So it basically states that whoever rape of any person or any woman which is in the custody of either first part is police officer, second any public servant, third jail authority or remand home or any other place of custody, or fourth the management or the staff of the hospital. If these are the person under which or in their premises, maybe it is a police station or the office of the public servant or the remand home, jail or other place of custody or the hospital, if any person or any head of these particular department will rape any woman or commit a rape on a woman, or any subordinate will commit a rape on a woman, the punishment will be for 10 years. And it may be for life and they are also liable for fine. Other than these categories, if there is a rape committed on a woman knowing her to be pregnant, again the punishment is 10 years. And if there anyone commits a rape on a woman when she is under 12 years of age, or if there is a gang rape, in all these categories, the punishment will be a rigorous punishment for a term which shall not be less than 10 years, but which may be for life and also be liable to fine. Although many amendments has been made after 2013, but still India is flooded with the rape, especially on minors. So in 2018, again amendment has been made, especially rape on minors. So after the amendment, apart from rape of women by police officer, public servant, member of the armed force, etc., Section 376 deals with 3 categories of punishment for rape. Now these 3 categories are, the first one is Section 376(1), that is for the general person. The punishment for a rape of a woman to be minimum 10 years rigorous imprisonment, which may extend to imprisonment for life. Now the point which has to be noted is, earlier it was minimum of 7 years. Now it is minimum of 10 years and maximum is for life imprisonment. Now Section 376(3), which is amended. Punishment for rape on a woman under 16 years of age, that means if the girl is of 16 years of age, then which is added is, the punishment in such case must be minimum of 20 years, which may extend to life imprisonment. That means if the girl is of 16 years, the punishment would be for 20 years, and which may extend to life imprisonment. And the third category is Section 376AB. That means punishment for rape on a woman under 12 years of age. If the girl is below 12 years, then the punishment in such case is defined as minimum 20 years rigorous punishment, which may extend to life imprisonment. And the offender in such case can also be punished with death penalty. This is very important. That means if the girl is below 12 years, then the punishment is minimum 20 years, which may extend to life imprisonment, and it may be death penalty. Now, the next category is sexual harassment of women at workplace. Again, this is a very common problem, and I think most of the women are facing such type of problem. So, according to the Indian Constitution, sexual harassment infringes the fundamental right of women to gender equality under Article 14 and her right to life and live with dignity under Article 21. So, this is not only a thing or an offense pertaining to criminal law, but this is also something which is related to the Constitution and the fundamental right. So what is sexual harassment, or what comes under the category of sexual harassment? This is very important for anyone, no matter this is a man or a woman. It is necessary to know so that if this type of activity is going on with you, you are facing such type of problem, you have to report it. And if a man are listening, please be aware. So any unwelcome sexual determined behavior, whether direct or by implication. Secondly, includes physical contact and advances. Third, a demand or request for sexual favors. Fourth, sexual colored remarks. Fifth, showing pornography. And another, unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of a sexual nature. All these things comes under the category of sexual harassment. And one more thing which I have to explain is sexual harassment is also offline and online. If the person is doing such type of things physically, it will be considered as offline sexual harassment at the workplace. And if any person who is posting a very dirty videos or any dirty messages or WhatsApp you, then that also comes under the category of sexual harassment at the workplace. The remedial measures under Vishakha Committee has been defined under the Sexual Harassment of the Women at the Workplace Act 2013, which defines that sexual harassment at the workplace and creates a mechanism for redressal of complaint. It also provides safeguards against false or malicious charges of female with the right to file a complaint against any sexual harassment at her place of work. The Act is extremely wide to cover all women, irrespective of her age or employment status, whether in the organized or unorganized sector, public or private, and covers client, customer, and domestic workers as well. It is also in the university, colleges, hospitals, schools, managements, business places, everywhere. So it is necessary to have a Vishakha committee everywhere. The committee is required to complete the inquiry if there is any complaint. It is required to complete the inquiry within a time period of 90 days. On completion of the inquiry, the report will be sent to the employer or the district officer, as the case may be. They are mandated to take action on the report within 60 days. In the event the committee finds that the allegation or allegations against the respondent has been proved, it shall recommend the nature of the action to be taken by the university or by the place or the workplace. Later on, every employer is required to constitute an internal complaint committee at each office or branch with 10 or more employees. the district officer is required to constitute a local complaint committee at each district and, if required, at the block level. The complaints committee have the power of civil court for gathering evidences. The complaint committee are required to provide for conciliation before initiating an inquiry, if requested by the complainant, which is important. The inquiry process under the Act should be confidential, and the Act lays down a penalty of ₹5,000 on the person who has breached confidentiality. These actions may be recommended. The first one is, first a person has to file complaint and a written apology. Then a warning can be given. Then he may withhold the promotion of that person, or undergoing a counseling session, or carrying out of community service, or terminating the respondent from class, or any other punishment according to the authority, if the charge has been proved. So this is the end of significance provisions for women in our Indian legal system, part 2. I hope you like the video, and if you like it, do not forget to hit the like button and subscribe my channel. If you want the detailed notes, you may visit to my website, that is priyasipaha.com, and you may also follow me on FB page, that is Law Colloquy, Instagram Law Colloquy, and Twitter Dr. Priya Sipaha. Thank you for watching. See you soon. Bye.